Greetings, I am Herbert Erpaderp, and today I'm going to build this Willys Jeep from Rubicon Models. Heh, Willys. Rubicon makes two versions of the Willys MB kit, US Army Standard and this, the Commonwealth version. I'm not 100% sure on how different they are, but I'm assuming the Commonwealth version just includes a few more or different parts to make the Commonwealth variants. The back of the box has a few images of the variants this kit can make. SAS, airborne, and long-range desert group versions. There is also a few paragraphs about the Jeep's development, some suggested paint colours, and an illustration of the included waterslide decal sheet. Inside the box we find three sprues and two slide moulded parts all individually bagged. There are quite a few parts in this kit, which makes sense with the number of variants you can make. There are different crew figures for those variants too, which is great. My bits box is salivating. As I have come to expect from Rubicon, these parts are all quite neat and well moulded with very good detail. There are mould lines of course, most prominently on the wheels and the sides of the crew figures. These aren't too bad and shouldn't require too much work to remove. I like that the crew figures are multi-part models, so you can have some variety in how you position them. This is especially good if you are making multiple Jeeps. The canopy, which is optional, is a single slide moulded part, and I think it looks pretty good. So is the main body of the Jeep. I quite like this. It looks good, and being a single part should make the assembly a little bit quicker and easier. Also included is this decal sheet. There's quite a few options for markings here, including Red Cross and military police markings, and plenty of numbers for British and American Jeeps, which is nice if you are going to make a bunch of these. You should easily be able to avoid having duplicate numbers. There is of course also the expected Allied stars. And of course there are instructions. As usual, Rubicon's instruction leaflet is quite good. It states right there on the second page that you should be careful, because these instructions cover two different kits, the standard US Jeep and of course this Commonwealth version. So obviously we need to pay attention to be sure we're putting the right parts on the model. Before we start putting parts together, a decision must be made. We need to choose which variant we want to build. I was tempted to build a standard version with the canvas canopy, because I think it looks good. The LDRG version looks pretty interesting too, as does the SAS version. But in the end, I decided to build the airborne one. I think that might fit in with the rest of my British Army a bit more than the others. Except maybe the standard one. That probably would have been a good option too. The airborne version isn't covered in guns, but it should be useful anyway. As the instructions suggest, I begin construction with the basic frame assembly. This should be more or less the same for all the variants. I am using Tamiya Extra Thin to glue this model. The glue I had previously been using ran out, and the local hobby store didn't have more, so I bought this. It has been suggested a few times that I try this glue out, and apparently it works well with the kind of plastic that Rubicon uses for their kits, so I figured why not try it out. I attach the front mudguard part to the frame. There's nothing to guide this, but you can see how the shape of the parts here might help to get the position right, but there's not really any horizontal guide. It seems like it would be very easy to get this wrong. Here's a way to make sure everything fits nicely. Use the Jeep's body as a guide. It doesn't exactly clip together, but the rear of the Jeep body and frame fit together very nicely and it should hold the mudguard part in place. This should make gluing the front mudguard part into place trivial. Just make sure you don't accidentally glue the mudguard to the upper half of the Jeep yet. I separate the parts and the result is a very neatly positioned set of front mudguards. It looks much neater than it probably would have if I didn't use the Jeep top as a guide. Next comes the dashboard, which has angled parts that allow it to easily slot into place. You should have no issues with this. I then add the radiator grille, though the instructions suggest that the wheels should go on first. I don't think it really matters though. The radiator goes into place very easily. Be sure that you choose the correct radiator part. Some variants use the part with a section of the grille missing to allow the air filter to fit. With that done, it's time to attach the wheels. These are numbered and have specific positions around the vehicle that you are meant to fit them to. I figure why not follow these instructions, though I'm pretty sure you could put the wheels on whichever axle you like and still have them fit. For this kind of thing, I like to set the wheels out next to their place on the model. Doing this helps me to keep track of them and avoid mixing them up while I'm removing mold lines. The wheels and axles have a D-shaped keying to ensure the wheels are positioned correctly, though there is still a little bit of play in the parts. The reason for the keying is the bottom part of the wheels is kind of flattened. I use the work surface to make sure all the flattened parts of the wheels are at the bottom, and everything lines up nicely with all the wheels in contact with the ground properly. I like it when models have wheels like this. It makes the vehicle look as though it has some weight to it. Next, if you're building certain variants of the Jeep, you might have to drill some holes to mount MG poles or shields. This is not needed for the airborne version, so I move on to adding whatever this part is. It's some kind of riser or storage box or something that goes under the driver's seat, and it's pretty easy to glue into place. Before I add the seats, I install the gear shifter. You'll need this if you want your Jeep to go anywhere. This part is pretty small, so you might benefit from using tweezers here. Then come the seats. These both have different keying, so you can't easily put the wrong seat on the wrong side. The right side seat has some risers to make it sit at the same height as the driver's with the box under it. The seats fit nicely in place with no issue. They look nice and seaty. Probably not especially comfortable though, but they do their job, I assume. Next, I join the upper and lower halves of the Jeep. The parts don't quite lock into place, but the fit is very precise and there's no play in it. I apply a little pressure to make sure the gaps are as minimal as I can make them. The model is designed such that the gaps actually look like they should be there, which is nice. This goes together rather nicely. If you're building the standard version, now would be the time to attach the windscreen, and I kind of wanted to attach the folded down version, but that's for the standard Jeep, and I'm building the airborne version, which doesn't have one. The windscreens were removed to make the Jeeps a little bit lighter. The airborne version does have a jerry can though, which goes on the right, as opposed to the left on some other versions. There's nothing to guide this, but that does mean you can position it wherever you want or omit it completely. There should also be a spare tire mounted on a bracket on the rear, but I'm going to deviate from the instructions a little bit here and put it on the front like so. I've seen pictures of airborne Jeeps like this and I thought it looked more interesting than having the spare tire on the rear. It's something that'll make this Jeep look a little bit different and stand out next to the other Rubicon Jeeps, at least those built according to the instructions. I then install an antenna mount. This is tiny and has no guides. Apparently there was no standard position for this, but it was usually on the rear of the vehicle somewhere, so put it where you like. You could make an antenna for this with some fine wire or brass rod or by melting and stretching out some sprue. I obviously haven't done that. Now it's time to attach the M2 machine gun. I started by gluing on this ammo box like so. I made the mistake of not test fitting this and the part didn't quite fit the gun properly, so there's a bit of a gap there. It's a bit annoying, but it's not horrendous, so I guess I'll live with it. The gun can then be glued into place here in front of the passenger's position. I guess he becomes a gunner instead of a passenger. There's nothing to guide the positioning of this gun, but it's fairly simple to eyeball. I have decided that I don't want to put a crew into my Jeep for various reasons, though the included Rubicon figures are fairly nice. I just tend to think that vehicles look better without people, so that's how I'm building it. That means I'll need to use the standalone steering wheel rather than one attached to a crew figure. This goes together easily and looks really good. There's a mounting hole for the steering shaft thing in the floor and a cutaway for it in the dashboard, which make it easy to glue into place. I use my knife to straighten it up a little bit and that's it. Jeep done. Unfortunately, I don't have any other Jeeps to compare this model with, and I'm actually tempted to get some more of these rather than a Jeep from another manufacturer, but we will see what the future holds. The back tray or passenger area or whatever you'd call that does look a little bit empty, and I'm considering adding some boxes or jerry cans to this model just to add some more interest. Obviously I haven't done so yet, but if I do, I'll probably include that in the painting video. I'm sure you can imagine for yourselves what gluing boxes and jerry cans into a Jeep might look like. I'm sure you don't need me to show you. Anyway, this is a very good kit. I expect that from Rubicon and they don't let me down. It was very easy and relatively quick to build and I had a good time putting it together. The instructions are clear and helpful. The parts go together nicely and are neatly molded with minimum mold lines. It's a small model, and despite the parts that are included in the box, there aren't a lot of parts that needed to be glued together, so it did go together pretty quickly. I think this will look pretty good amongst my British forces. I don't have a specifically airborne force, I have commandos and regular infantry models, but I like to think this will fit in with those guys. They're my army, so they do what I say anyway. I am definitely thinking of getting more of these, at least one, maybe two or three for my American army. It's definitely a good kit, and I recommend it to anyone who needs a Jeep or two or ten. They're a pretty ubiquitous vehicle, so I don't think there are many armies who can't use a Jeep. What do you think? Have you built the Rubicon Jeep? Is there a better Jeep kit in this scale that you want me to check out? Let me know what you think in the comment section below. And of course, if you haven't done so already and you want to be super rad, feel free to subscribe to me here on YouTube, follow me on social media, and watch me live stream on Twitch. And if you really like the things I do, please consider helping to support the channel over at Patreon, where we have cookies. They might be cookies of the imagination, but that still counts, right? Links to all of those things are in the description. I shall return soon, so until then, happy modelling and thanks for watching. Farewell.